The history of the USO goes back 25 years. When the war was growing closer to the United States in 1940, the agencies that operated separately in World War I were drawn together to share their experiences so as to better serve the armed forces should another national emergency arise. These agencies are the Young Men's Christian Association, the National Catholic Community Service, the National Jewish Welfare Board, the Young Women's Christian Association, the Salvation Army. They were later joined by the National Travelers Aid Association. A federation of these agencies seemed the answer. Accordingly, the United Service Organizations, USO, was born and granted a charter as a nonprofit corporation. Even before the ink was dry on the new charter, the ideal, the need of the USO, caught on like wildfire. Hundreds of thousands of young Americans were being called to service by the draft, and in civic buildings across the nation were making their pledge to defend with their lives the freedom into which they were born. From every corner of the country they came, to military camps geared to making soldiers out of civilians. Time was short. For these men, the transition from civilian to combat-bound soldier was a swift and often confusing change. They bore it well. The nation was proud of them. All over America in 1941, USO clubs were springing up. Volunteers, old and young, streamed in to give every serviceman a hero's reception and farewell to the fighting fronts overseas. Entertainers from Broadway and Hollywood were signing up. These soldiers in grease paint were to bring live entertainment all over the world, wherever our troops were deployed. They have written an heroic and gallant chapter in the history of American show business. They wrote it by giving copiously of their own special gifts, the ability to evoke a laugh, to push fear and loneliness out of the mind for a time with the deft, light therapy of the clown. At home, they went on the road, not for box office receipts, but to sell war bonds. No one was too big or too busy. And they sold bonds in the tens of millions. For some, there was a new and challenging role in uniform. Jimmy Stewart, Jackie Coogan, Tyrone Power, Douglas Fairbanks Jr., Robert Taylor, Clark Gable. Gable's wife, Carol Lombard, lost her life on a Bond tour. And you may remember the four Jills in a Jeep. Carol Landis, Kay Francis, Mitzi Mayfair, and Martha Ray. They hit North Africa in 1942. Al Jolson was there too, belting them out as always, and playing MC for other troopers like Merle Oberon. More than 600 entertainers went overseas in the first 2 years of the war. Patricia Morrison was there. And old pros like Frank McHugh and Alan Jenkins, they dusted off the old vaudeville routines, worked around the clock, and always left them laughing. In the CBI, Captain Melvin Douglas headed up Special Services. Ann Sheridan was there, and Ben Blue, and Jackie Miles. Wherever Americans in uniform might get a lift from the sight of a pretty face, the USO troopers went. And there was magic in what the slack-jointed improvising of a Ray Bolger could do for the morale of men who knew only too well how much that rifle weighed. Or in swapping grins with Mickey Rooney. Jack Benny and Ingrid Bergman gave it all they had, every performance. And it was a thrill to lift a mug with Jimmy Cagney. Or shake Bob Hope's hand between shows and thank him for the laughs he'd brought. The bits didn't need to be original. They were surefire because they were played against the background of this fact. Somebody had cared enough to come all this way just to bring some fun, some smiles. Yes, there were well-knowns and the little-knowns, the ones you'll never see pictures of because nobody was around with a movie camera. Nobody was around but the audience, 3 men in a tent or 3,000 jamming an airfield, watching entertainers probably unknown to you. They came to give, and they worked at it. They work anywhere under whatever conditions they ran into, and famous or unknown, they were appreciated. 2, 3, 4 performances a day on a stage or on a sheet of plywood in a clearing, it made no difference to them or to the men they played for. From soggy jungle islands in the Pacific to the beachhead at Normandy and eastward, where American fighting men went, the USO was to follow. It's impossible to estimate the morale value of what these people gave. Or perhaps more truly, it's impossible to overestimate. At last it was over. The big job was done. It was done, and the boys who had done it were ready to come home, but they couldn't come home all at once. USO had enlisted for the duration. Who could foretell that the duration for USO, like that of the armed forces, was to continue for decades after the war had been won? Packed houses again. That was Korea when it came. And again the magic words were passed among the men. USO show today. Perhaps it was a comedian of the old school like Wally Vernon. Or matinee idol John Hall introducing Frances Langford, back again to sing for the sons of men she had entertained in the Pacific during World War II. Or perhaps some of the latest hits from home served up in a mixture of spice and sugar frosting by Debbie Reynolds. There's nothing the stars won't do for a laugh, especially when their audience has paid the price of admission with hardship and danger. Stars and superstars, each delivering in his own way the same message, one that men far from home never tire of hearing. We have not forgotten.